Yeah, so hi everyone. My name is Omer. This talk is about key management in the blockchain context using threshold cryptography. I would like to start with the motivation. Let's imagine we have a key management system with the following properties. So first, we want security with no single point of failure. This means we take out any centralized element and make it decentralized, including the private keys. However, we do want to maintain the concept of a single owner, since we assume that there is one, at least logical owner to a private key. So we do this by the following two assertions. The owner that I will define later must approve or be part of any publicly verifiable statement using the private key, also known as signatures. And finally, we require that at any state of the system, the owner would be able to exit gracefully without any impact to his assets, meaning that you'll be able to move out of the system and to another system anytime he wants. So most of the focus of this talk would be on this last requirement, showing eventually one way that this kind of system is possible and maybe even practical. I will get the help from our friends Rick and Morty. And to outline the talk, so I would start with some kind of background on key management systems and why they are considered hard. We'll then introduce threshold signatures and see where this gets us, what we call a mixed model. And to complete the gap, I'll introduce a new construction that we came up with in this work, which stands for, this is TMOVE, it stands for threshold multiple output verifiable encryption. I will explain about it later. And then we instantiate it and show how it can be used to achieve verifiable social recovery that will help us to complete the system as we want. So key management system in the context of blockchains, I want to focus on three main functionalities, namely the key generation, the signing, and the backup. So there are a few things we can say about relations between these functionalities. First, there is a trade-off between security and the signing or the usability, right? If you'll agree with me that if you want to make your system as secure as possible, you just keep the keys where you generated them and never use them. But in blockchain, we do need to use them and we need to use them a lot. So this is kind of the tension here or the trade-off. Another important relation is between the key generation and the backup, or the primary method of keeping your key safe and the secondary method. So from system engineering perspective, we know that both of them should have kind of the same security or the same security assumptions, right? Otherwise, an attacker will go to the easy path and will just the other path will not be that relevant, okay? So this is another important relation. Now, what makes key management hard? So there are a few, actually many reasons. To name a few, so we have side channels attacks, such as I gave you the example of wallet fail that shows some nice side channels in hardware wallets, such as power glitches. We also have social engineering attacks. I gave you the example of Electrum wallet. Fabricate a message to the user and direct him to some place. And you also have human errors, as I showed in the example of the parity bug. So one solution we know to this is to delegate the key management to a third party that we trust to let them manage our keys. So is this a good solution? I would claim that it's not an ideal solution. So first, from security perspective, it might even be less secure than the previous method. And also, this is creating centralized elements in the system that we try, this is what we try to avoid. So question remains, how can we optimize on the security of the keys without compromising on their usabilities? So enter threshold cryptography, and specifically threshold signatures, and I would focus on the two functionalities. One is the distributed key generation among N parties, and the second is signing that requires a threshold number. We call it T, out of these N parties. So the takeaway here is that there are actually two. One is that there is this parameter N, okay, that we need to decide what it is to define the system. So there's a parameter that we'll discuss later. And the second, that efficient protocols for threshold signatures exist, okay? To give an example, so ECDSA is considered one of the more difficult to thresholdize protocol for digital signatures, and unfortunately it's being used in Bitcoin, in Ethereum, and many other chains. And just for the past 12 months, we saw three different papers that gave very nice protocols that are also very efficient. And if you want to play with them, I encourage you to check our GitHub and try it. So just a quick detour. I guess that some of you ask yourself, so this sounds a lot like multisig, and I just want to point that this is not multisig, so there are differences and there are similarities. I will not have time to go over the entire list, but maybe just one point, and of course, I encourage you to check online. There are some nice write-ups. I reference here ours, but there are some others that do the comparison between multisig and threshold signatures. To give you the sense of what I mean, so rotation, the third line means, or in cryptography, proactive secret sharing. This is something that it's easy to achieve and very cheap in threshold crypto, in threshold signatures. What I mean is that the parties will rotate their secret shares such that the security means that you need to attack few places at the same time. Okay, now if you want to do it with multisig, you need to go through the blockchain to make a transaction. It is slower. It might be even more expensive. I went to the trouble to find like a good way to remember it. So this is a miracle. Okay, so now that we have our mixed mode, our threshold signature baked in, let's see what where this gets us. So first, there is a new role that just emerged. So let's try to understand what it is. So, as I said, I want to assume that we have one owner in the system, okay? One private key and one owner. The owner will be defined as the one that moves the assets or funds or money or, from another system into the system, okay? So he has a kind of incentive or stake or skin in the game, if you'd like to. So this is the owner, and the rest of the parties, the rest of the N minus one parties would be service providers. So in terms of their cryptographic role, they will be identical maybe, but in more higher layer, they would need to be incentivized in some other way, okay? So I would first want to focus on the key, on the simple case of one service provider. So let's see what we get in terms of system properties, system requirements from this specific case, and then I would say a few words on the general case and why I'm avoiding it for now. So. Let's see, so we get that there is no single point of failure, just out of the box. This is just because an attacker needs to get to attack both parties, the owner and the service provider, to get the full private key. And we also even get that signing cannot happen without the owner approval, because this is also have a threshold that is required both parties to participate. So the owner must take part. But recovery, and this is the question that I will focus for the rest of the talk, whether it is possible that at any given time, the owner can decide and just move all of his assets out of the system, okay? So just a quick few words about parameters in general. So I kind of, I would say it like this. There is dependency on the adversary model. Like I said, it's not just the cryptography, and it really depends. And based on this adversary model, there might be other access structure that can work also. But I would say that if we assume that the service provider is motivated by some kind of economical gain, and we want to maintain this system properties that I introduced before, so we eventually will end up with this recovery problem, so this is still interesting. And I would also claim, and I hope that you'll agree with me, that two-party protocols are generally easier to work with than the multi-party case. So for now, we'll focus on this two-party simple case, and I hope it will be enough. Now, let's define the problem of recovery in this case. So simply put, we have two secret shares, represented here by the owner secret share, which is the orange one, and the service provider secret share, which is the blue one. And the private key is a function of both. So the recovery is actually, it can be divided into two different problems. One I call the self-recovery, which means that what the owner should do if something happened to his secret share, to the orange key. And the second problem is the counterparty recovery, and this is the more interesting problem, as we'll see in a few seconds. And this is the problem of what happens if something happened to the service provider, and the blue key needs to be somehow reconstructed by the owner for him to have the full private key. So, starting from the self-recovery problem, and this is actually can be. Can be reduced into what we see today in wallets. So you assume that you have some kind of secondary place to keep this private key or secret share. You can just use it. I would say, without going into details, that under the assumption of authentication in the system, we are able to maintain this property of no single point of failure even further on. Okay? And now to the more interesting problem, as I told you, how can the owner recover in the case that something happened to the service provider, if it goes offline, if it becomes DDoSed or hacked or malicious or whatever, okay? And of course, this can be a very easy problem if we assume that there is some other element in the system, for example, an escrow, and this escrow is been able to somehow get a life signal from the service provider and based on it do something. But this is something that we want to avoid because, it introduced some new elements to the system, and specifically it brings us back to the trusted third party problem that we wish to avoid. So what's the idea? So we first need to do a little tweak, and this is the following. We need to have the service provider to run, to have one service provider to many owners, okay? So this does not affect security in any way. The service provider will just run the key generation with each owner separately, and eventually you'll have a bunch of those secret shares that belongs to different owners. Now, what will happen is that the service provider, once he goes away or something happened to him, the owners will be able to collaborate in some kind of a protocol which we call TMove, and at the end, they will get, at the same time, each will get his own counterparty secret share. So again, the service provider will run key generation with each owner separately, but after the key generation, he will also provide them with some additional data for each service provider, for each owner, such that if something happens to him, they will be able to run a protocol and get back the secret shares, okay? So before we explain about TMove, I need to give a bit of background. So publicly verifiable secret sharing, we touched it a bit before in a previous talk. So I'll just introduce my notation. So it's very simple. We have a dealer with a secret S, and he wants to distribute his secret, so we divide it into N secret shares, so to N multis. And what's also nice in the publicly verifiable, the publicly verifiability here is that it can provide a proof that, a public proof that this is actually a correct secret sharing. So these blue creatures, these MISICs, will represent the public, and you'll see them a lot in the next slides because everything we do from now on will be publicly verifiable. It's really important for the construction. So now at a later point in time, if we want to have a reconstruction, we need T out of this N multis that will publish their secret shares, and they will be able to reconstruct the secret S. Also, this part is also publicly verifiable, such that each multi can prove that his secret share indeed belongs to this secret. So this is one thing that we need to understand. The second is a construction called D-log verifiable encryption. It's based on a paper, a fantastic paper from 15 years ago by Jan Kemenich and Victor Shoup, and what we have here is that we have an encryption scheme, and we also have a D-log relation, so it's not really important that this is a D-log relation. It's actually an elliptic curve D-log relation. We use this specific relation because it's what's relevant for blockchains, and the point here is that we have this multi that generates a keeper, a private key and a public key, and then comes Rick, and with a special encryption protocol, he can take a witness, and he outputs ciphertext and a proof. So the proof is something that can be publicly verifiable to show that the ciphertext is indeed of the specific witness of this D-log relation. And now, if at later point in time this multi wants to decrypt, so he can run a special decryption protocol on the ciphertext, using his private key, okay, and get back the witness. Nice. So the first construction that is new in this work, and I want to explain, it's a step towards TMOV. It's called threshold verifiable encryption. So let's go over it and then explain. So again, we have an encryption scheme, and we have the DLOG relation, and we have Morty that generates this Morty M that generates a key pair, a private key and public key. Then comes the encryptor, and he has some witness that he wants to encrypt, so he outputs a ciphertext and a proof. Now, the proof is, again, publicly verifiable to show that the ciphertext C is indeed of the witness, W. And now what the difference comes from the point that the encryptor becomes also a dealer. He distributed, he runs the distribute phase of the PVSS, so he distributes secret shares to these N Mortys, and again, it's publicly verifiable. And then if at later point in time, this Morty M wants to reconstruct, so first he needs this N Mortys to, or at least T out of them, to publish their secret shares. And only then he can take these secret shares and his private key, and then he can decrypt the witness. So this is kind of a double lock mechanism, okay? And this is what makes it non-trivial, meaning it's not just a concatenation of the previous two constructions that that I showed you, PVSS and verifiable encryption, because this is where they are bounded together. This Morty needs to decrypt using both, first to have the secret shares and also have at the same time his secret key. Okay, so now we can finally introduce threshold multiple output verifiable encryption. It will be very easy. And again, we start with an encryption scheme and the DLOG relation. And now we have N outputs or N ciphertext and the proof. And Rick will be able to output them such that it will be publicly verifiable that the ciphertext, each one corresponds to a specific witness. And we again start with the phase of PVSS distribution. So it's not just one, as you can see. There are M PVSS or M secrets that are going to be distributed. And then if at later point in time we want to have a decryption, the decryption will happen all at once. We need to have some reconstruction of the secret shares. We then and only then, using the secret shares, each, or the K Morty, can take his secret key, the secret shares, and output, using a special decryption algorithm, output his witness WK. Okay, so let's talk about the properties of this construction. So what we get here is that we have threshold verifiable encryption per party. But it's not the same as running threshold verifiable encryption N times. And this is one because of efficiency. So this protocol runs in parallel and needs less than N times PVSS schemes. It needs just M, which can be smaller. But more importantly, we have this property of gradual release, meaning that let's think what will happen if we run this protocol, N TVE protocols. So the first Morty, and there will always be a first Morty, he will get his witness, and then the second will get. But after they will get their witnesses, they will probably abort from the protocol, okay? This is what makes sense. They have no reason to continue in the protocol. So the last Mortys will not have enough other Mortys to participate with them to get them also the witnesses. So what happens here is that we need this gradual release, meaning that we are releasing the witnesses all at the same time, one segment by the other. So each time we will release, reconstruct one secret from a secret sharing scheme, we'll get all N Mortys will get one segment. And assuming the segments are small enough, if now one Morty is aborting the protocol, so all Mortys will have more or less the same amount of witness that they recover up to one plus minus one segment that if it's the segment is small enough, it can be it's neglectable. Okay, so how we instantiate it? So we use additively homomorphic encryption scheme. We specifically chose El Gamal in the exponent, and this scheme, as you can see, the encryption instead of being of W is encryption of WG, and this is what gets it the property of additively homomorphism, as you can see below. And we basically generate a lot of those. So the encryptor generates a lot of this C1s, IJ. So in this case, you can see that this is the encryption of the witness for for multi I, for party I, okay, and this is the J segment for this witness. And you can also see the double lock mechanism on the second element. This is the alpha J PKI, meaning that only the multi that has the secret key I and also reconstructed the alpha J will be able to recover, assuming that the segment is small enough, you will be able to recover this segment of W. This is publicly verifiable, so we need to make it verifiable encryption, we need to add some zero knowledge proofs here, basically to show that this is the right structure when we publish this, when Rick, the encryptor, is publishing this, he needs to show this is the right structure. You also need to show that the witnesses' segments are small enough. So for this, for example, we use bulletproof by changing this C1 into a Peterson commitment by one zero knowledge proof, and then using bulletproof as a range proof. And the gradual release, we get it by the fact that we are reconstructing one alpha J at a time. So each time we get one alpha J, all parties get at the same time one segment using their secret key. Okay, so how can this be used for key recovery? So let's start by looking at the case of one service provider and one owner, and they run two-party key generation. As we mentioned before, the private key will be a function of both secret shares, and the problem is how the owner will be able to get the secret share SR at any point in time. So right after the two-party key generation, the service provider will also run the encryption phase, encrypting SR, and also the distribution of PVSS for party I, okay? So this can happen like for every party separately. And this is publicly verifiable, meaning that the owner knows that this was done correctly. Now, the owner can transfer funds into the system, knowing that if something happened to the service provider, we'll be able to collaborate with other owners under the same service provider, such that they will be able to reconstruct all the secret sharing, all the secrets from the secret sharing scheme, and then we'll be able to decrypt locally and get his own SR secret share and then the full private key. So to recap, we looked at the two-party case where we have one owner and one service provider, and now we showed that recovery can be done under some tweaking to the system. So I showed that key management is a hard problem. We introduced threshold signatures, what we called mixed model. We show what it gets us, which is no single point of failure in this specific case. We then describe threshold multiple output verifiable encryption and show that if we assume that all multis under the same service provider will have the same motivation to step out of the system, then by collaboration, they can achieve this verifiable social recovery. And that's it.
Okay, we have time for some questions. Let me ask one question. So how do you, how do you choose the threshold of owners that you need to recover, and how do you contrast that with the threshold that you need for the signature? I know you talked about the two-party case for the signing, but...
Yeah, so this is a good question, and I would also say that there are a lot of practical consideration that I kind of ignored in this in this talk so far, to focus just on the T-move. So I don't really know, have the answer what's supposed to be the right number of threshold, because it depends on other number of parameters. So it's an open question.
And then you have a question.
Could you review again how the first Mortis prevent, or basically, I'm still not sure how the first Morty can not grief the other Mortys in the key recovery, because I understand that you chop up all the keys to incrementally reconstruct them, but
yes, yeah, so
so that alpha there,
we have M segments. Okay, so we take a witness and we chop it into M segments. Let's assume that M is chosen such that the segments are small enough to be able to reconstruct the segment W out of WG. Okay, but now each segment, we also have M, this same number of M is also used as M PVSS schemes. So we have M secret sharing schemes, and the gradual release works such that we are completing all mortise or threshold out of them needs to complete this PVSS scheme one at a time. So once you got the first PVSS, all mortise will be able to get the first segment. Once you got the second, all mortise will get the second. Once you got the M1, all mortise will get everyone.
And the last question I had was, is there a potential attack that the dealer could segment the mortise so he could broadcast, you know, one round to, you know, a subset of the mortise and another, you know?
So I would also put it in the same bucket of practical considerations. I even have a slide on this. This is all good questions. I mean, you can think about it like in a thought experiment. I mean, there might be some kind of attacks that I'm not aware of. I do know that there are a lot of practical considerations. This is not something you can just take and deploy and it will work out of the box.
Thanks.
Okay. Well, let's thank the speaker again.